our concepts of God keep changing, don't they? And right now, what is gradually percolating into the ideation of some here in this world is the fact that God has never been angry at the sun. Zero anger, zero disappointment, complete confidence that the sun will choose a different idea. Okay? That is the truth. And God has never sanctioned attack on anything or anyone. Zero attack. Attack is never justified. God is not saying that someone needs to be attacked for any reason whatsoever. That's also a fact. Because everything that we've tried to do has had zero effect on reality. Every attempt to negate reality that we've ever attempted, no effect whatsoever. So what is there to be angry about? God has never been attacked. Why should the Prime Creator be upset? Upset over fantasies, upset over hypothetical scenarios. The Prime Creator knows we are simply engaging in a hypothetical scenario, a what if. What if it were possible to negate the Prime Creator? God doesn't pay any attention to that. He knows it's just a hypothetical. We're just fantasizing, just imagining. So God is just ready, waiting to welcome us home. Welcome us back to giving up the attempt to replace the Prime Creator. That's all. That's the true update for the concept of God, to see God that way, because that's the fact, that's the truth. Now, throughout history, we've had many, many different concepts of deity. If you want to take a look at history, we can do that just a little bit. Something that's quite interesting, it may help you. Have you ever heard of ENSO? ENSO, it means El Niño-Southern Oscillation. Scientists have now gotten to the point where they understand that there's a vast engine that drives the world's weather. And specifically, the Southern Oscillation of El Niño, which is responsible for the monsoons in India, as well as the precipitation in China, as well as a great deal of weather all over. Now, throughout history, most people have been subsistence farmers, little plot of rice. They don't have much rice stored. They don't have any much distribution networks. It's whatever you can raise on your little plot of land. Now when El Niño kicks in, and the trade winds shift, the monsoons fail. They don't arrive. Drought strikes the land. People begin to starve to death. And when El Niño goes on for several years, then you have a massive famine. Two countries have been hit very hard by this. It have been China and India. But all over the world, famine has been really the greatest killer of all. And it's periodic. It continually happens over and over and over. You imagine being a subsistence farmer, and the monsoon season is here, and you're looking in the sky, and it's clear, cold. The air is coming down from the mountains across the plain, and it's dry and cold instead of warm and moist from the ocean. And you wait day after day after day, and the monsoon doesn't show up. And you start to get this dread. And before too long, you realize it's not coming. There's no rain. And you see the crops withering. And you realize you don't have any food to eat. And you start trying to eat whatever you can. People in famine will just, you know, try to grab a hold of anything possible that can eat. It's a horrible, horrible situation for humans. It's the worst. Famine is just the worst. And yet this has happened over and over throughout history. Throughout history of human civilization on this planet. Continuous patterns of famine. Perhaps hundreds and hundreds of famines. Maybe even more than that. Dreadful, dreadful, dreadful experiences for those who go through it. To see everybody, their friends, their loved ones, their children, just wasting away into nothing but bones, walking skeletons. Now, they didn't know why the rain didn't come. And so, imagine in their terrified condition of this famine, they begin to think, what can we do? Is there any way to bring the rain? And so they begin to believe that there's a god, some deity they can pray to. They build a statue or something. They go there and say, give offerings and money and flowers and all these wonderful offerings to this deity and say, deity, please bring the rain. We need the rain. We're terrified. We're going to starve to death. And you can real understand why anyone going through that would just make up whatever they can to give themselves some hope, some control over the situation. They never knew it was El Niño Southern Oscillation. It's part of the planet's weather dynamics. And by the way, those of you who think this planet's such a wonderful place, there was no global warming throughout history. There was no environmental damage throughout history when all this was happening. This is a natural cycle. A natural cycle that devastates humanity over and over and over and over again, causing the most incredible, terrifying misery of huge, massive famines. And the famines are followed by pestilence and epidemics and plagues like smallpox and cholera. People are just devastated by this. Their immune system, their resistance to the disease drops so low. And this is something that just happens naturally. It's part of the cycles of nature here on this planet. And as I have said, this entire planet, everyone here, is for the purpose of researching negation, destruction, death. And so that is what happens here. So concepts of deities got built up over time. Almost all the deities were representing dynamics of nature. Earthquakes, fires, floods, drought, pestilence, epidemics, all these things. There are deities that try and control these things. And so there's gradually built up the idea that there's some deity that is controlling nature and bringing all these plagues and problems on humanity. And it's because of our behavior is causing all this. And if we just please the deity in some way, then the deity will stop bringing this famine on us. And people must believe, wow, this deity gets very angry if we just do something wrong. We don't please the deity. The deity gets so upset that they cause the rain to stop coming and we're all going to starve to death. You can see how over the millennia of these atrocious famines that people will build up belief system layer after layer after layer after layer of beliefs that somehow there's some deity to propitiate so that these terrible disasters won't happen. Now, living in a situation where we don't have famine at this time, in a land for instance, like the United States, that has never had really bad famine. That type of belief, it just doesn't seem to arise at all. At least, doesn't arise for me at all. Now, if I had gone through famine, I might be thinking differently, but during the good times, when there is food and there's a culture that is not obsessed with trying to propitiate nature deities, it's possible to get a better view of the situation, even to see all the way through the entire situation. Scientists now know, have taken the measurements, that we understand the dynamics of El Nino to a large extent, and we know it is the cause of the weather. There's not some deity causing this problem. It's a natural cyclical occurrence. God, the prime creator, doesn't have anything to do with nature, with this planet, with human beings, with all this experiencing that's taking place. All of this is a research project on negation that the Son of God is choosing to carry out, because the Son of God wants to develop the power of negation that can negate the prime creator so that the Son of God can be the prime creator. So all of this negation that takes place on this planet, all of the famines, everything, all of that is part of this research experiment. All these dynamics that are set in place, this earth has been set up like a vast sacrificial machine. All these dynamics cause cyclical negations, cyclical problems, vast array of inimical, let's try that again, a vast array of harmful effects in this world. Really almost an unlimited number of ways to cause troubles here. ENSO is just one of them, but it's been a devastating one. God is not the author of any of this. Never has been, never will. God did not create negation. It's not God's will that any negation take place whatsoever. The Son of God is imagining all this, carrying out a hypothetical research project, researching negation. Now, since God is not causing anything in existence to take place, God does not need to be propitiated or worshipped in that way to say, please, please, God, please stop killing everybody and venting your anger with these terrible storms and earthquakes and tsunamis and stuff. What can we do to get you to calm down? Can we offer up a sacrificial victim to take out your wrath upon this sacrificial victim? None of that is true. Okay? Don't need to do any of that. These are very primitive concepts of God. Very mistaken, false, primitive concepts. Need to go past those now. Set them down. They have no use for us. No usefulness. God does not need to be calmed down or propitiated. God is perfect peace, perfect calm, perfect love, perfect stability, perfect safety, perfect invulnerability, perfect eternal life, perfect bliss. All we need to do is repent. Do not propitiate or offer up sacrificial victims, but to repent. Meaning, to choose again, to change what idea we want to experience. That's what repent means, to change the idea we want to experience. Instead of wanting to experience the idea of trying to replace God the Prime Creator by finding a power of negation to accomplish this, instead we choose the idea of not trying to replace God the Prime Creator, and therefore we don't have to do any research into negation. Therefore, we are free to dwell in the death-free realms, the non-negation realms, where there's none of that sickness. There's no ENSO there. Everything is immaculately well. Completely fresh, perfect, immaculate, always. That is what we really deserve. Because we are eternal and immaculate and invulnerable. Our true identity is that. These human beings that we have imagined, that those are not our true identities at all. Have nothing to do with what we are. And the sufferings that they go through have nothing to do with what we are at all. Zero. So why keep on doing it? We will do it as long as we continue to choose the idea of trying to replace God, the prime creator, and thus having these effects of negation, research project into negation. We will continue until we repent, choose a different idea, choose the idea of non-negation. Then we are free. Our destiny opens up and we're free to go into the non-death realms. No more famine. No famine there. No disease, no tsunamis, no earthquakes, no lightning and thunder, no deluges, no pole shifts, no superstorms, no gamma ray meltdowns, no galactic superstorms, no asteroids. Simply a perfectly safe, serene, incredibly beautiful, radiantly beautiful, and unharmed realm that you can dwell in. And by so doing, you become aware of the true nature of your identity. It reflects it back to you, and you lose your fear to look within. You look within and then you see, of course, that's what I am. This is very, very important to realize. We have been immersed in very false concepts of God. Really insane concepts. No matter how you dress them up, you can build the most grandiose church or temple in the world around these false concepts doesn't make them any more true. Likewise, or conversely, you can build no temple at all, no church at all around the truth. Let it be just completely plain. Doesn't make it any less true, does it? Truth is true. And lies will never be true. No matter what kind of frame you build around the lies, no matter how grandiose it is, it will never be true. And the qualities we have ascribed to God, the prime creator, are simply not true. It's time to accept this. I know there's a lot of people in this world, a lot of aspects of spirit in this world that are accepting this. They know it's true, and they're moving on now from this barbaric, false image we have of God, the prime creator. And yet moving beyond this is only the first step. You have to continue on to repentance, to exchanging ideas, setting down the idea of negation, picking up the idea of non-negation. It's easy to do that once you realize that God is not angry at you. You don't need any defensiveness. You don't need to hide anywhere. You don't need to offer up any sacrificial victims. You don't need to use things as shields, like an army, to protect you from God's wrath and let all your soldiers die for you. And hopefully you can preserve your own life. Don't need any of that. Don't need to hide in any darkness. Don't need to cling to some negation that you think when God comes after you in wrath, you'll be able to use that negation to counteract it. You see all these children's cartoons where all these psychic powers of energy are being used, zapping each other and blocking the energy of someone else. Constant combat, psychic combat with energies. Don't need any of that. God is not sending some kind of energy at you, trying to zap you with it. You don't need any sort of psychic powers to deflect that, to shield yourself from it. All this teaching that these cartoons are doing to children is such an unbelievable detour into fear. Gives a completely wrong notion and idea. All they're doing is they're practicing, you see. They're practicing defensiveness and negation at the same time. How can we negate that horrible monster that's coming at us? How can we shield ourselves from the blast that monster is sending towards us? That's the play of existence. That is all very serious, serious stuff. You know, if you try to take these games and cartoons away from kids, they get furious. Because for them, it's absolutely all important what they're doing. They're working on something, a project that is they feel is absolute necessity in order to protect themselves, in order to survive. Because they feel that there's someone's going to come after them with, you know, this power to wipe them out, and they've got to be able to protect themselves and in turn wipe that power out. These are the silly games of existence. Terrible, terrible, fear-based foolishness that arises from the idea of negation, of researching into negation. The idea of wanting to replace the Prime Creator has to have the effects of searching for a power of negation. There's no way around that. And therefore, negation, searching for negation, gives rise to all these horrible fear-based scenarios and role-playing and games that people are so seriously and so intensely into. And you may think that this is just normal and everybody does this. Not true. I don't do it. Never did. Never played any of those role games. Never watch any of the video games. Never play any of the video games. Zero interest in any of that. I saw immediately. No. This is based on a totally false misunderstanding of God the Prime Creator and a continued fixation with the idea of negation, trying to replace the Prime Creator. And all this role playing, all that, that's the purpose of it. It's not just some silly thing that kids are doing. It's very purposeful. And of course, adults do it also in many ways. It's kill or be killed type of thing. Survival of the fittest. All based on fear-based, believing that God is out to kill us because the Prime Creator knows we're out to kill the Prime Creator. So we have to protect ourselves from being wiped out and find a way to wipe out the Prime Creator. That's all this combat. That's the root of it, the base of it, the foundation of it. When you realize that that is not true, then your interest in those things really drops off into nothing. You're not interested in violence. Sure, they can make it seem funny and interesting and put all sorts of bells and whistles on it, you know, and you might look at it and say, ah. But really, your interest is almost zero. Just immediately say, ah, dismiss it, not interested. What you become interested in is profound beauty and peace. Lasting beauty. Beauty that can be counted upon. Not to age, not to wither, not to be affected by dynamics of nature. You want to find that. People trek all over the world trying to find it. There are people whose goal in life is to find the best place in the world. And they'll spend all their money and time trekking all over the world trying to find some unbelievable serenity and beauty. And of course, when they find it, what they find out is there's all sorts of things that bother them. You know, you might find a vast river in the middle of a jungle so peaceful and beautiful. But, you know, your supplies or your food is running out. You can only stay there for 2 days. And the rains come, and it's miserable. And you catch a disease, and the bugs are bothering you. And the people don't want you there. They're hostile to you. So, you see, no matter what you do here, you never find what you really want. In this world, it's impossible. It doesn't exist. The death-free realm does not exist in this world. It exists within you as your true identity, and some have turned within and tried to maintain their attention on their true identity. It's a very difficult thing to do in this world. Some people do it for when they're in deep meditation, but it takes some tremendous effort and focus and purpose for that, and a large support group. You still need the food, you still need a house or some place to stay, you're still bothered by the weather, and all sorts of things that can interfere. Curious people saying, what are you doing, you know, throwing stones at you. It's a very, very tough thing to do here. Many have tried, but it's far better to go relocate to the death-free realms. That's the safe way, it's the easiest way. You don't have to come here into this world and keep trying to meditate on yourself. That's the difficult way, very difficult. When you do that, you have all sorts of people come see you. They want to form all these survival relationships with you. Codependency things. They expect you to heal this and heal that, and they expect you to, you know, solve the problems of the dynamics of nature, control the weather, do all these miracles, you know, miracles of controlling nature, controlling sickness, controlling wealth, controlling all the dynamics and effects of this dream. That's what they expect of you, which is just nonsense. You can't do it. Certain things can be done, but the demands never stop. Everybody wants a child, you know. They want a better a job. They want to form relationships with you. Everybody's pulling, you know, from different directions, trying to tear you apart, and you're trying to maintain focus on the self, on yourself. Very, very difficult. Why would you want to do that? It's far better to go relocate to the death-free realms. There, success is guaranteed. There's no distractions. There's no smallpox. There's no bubonic plague there. There's no bird flu there. There's no swine flu. There's no viruses. There's no AIDS. There's nothing that can cause any negation whatsoever. Everything there is perfectly safe from negation. Eternally safe. That's the safe way. Why not take the safe way? Why try to be some kind of hillbilly hero and come into this world and try to focus on the self here? Where it's so incredibly difficult, and where you're going to be hit by every type of difficulty and distraction. Those who do that have not repented. They're still thinking, "Well, I want to control it all myself because I don't quite trust God. God might still be angry with me. I'm not sure. He might be unsupportive. So." I'm going to do it myself. I'm going to do it here in the realm of negation, just in case there's some trouble. I still have all this negation to hide behind. You know, there's all this, I can identify with all this negation here if I need be. So it's kind of like a safety net here to people who are still fearful. But if you've lost your fear of the Prime Creator, then you will automatically realize that the safe way, the best way, is to go to the relocate to the death-free realms. Nothing to hide there. You don't need to hide. Let's say, in this world here, there are people, you know, there might be some terrible catastrophe, you know, and people will say, oh my gosh, God is trying to kill us and crush us, and And then we will say, well, what kind of power do we have to stop this? And people go see you and ask you, please help, please help, please help. And that happens to those who come in this world who are perfectly identified with the self, the true self, the eternal self. When catastrophe happens, people go to them pleading, please do something, stop it. Stop the plague, stop the famine. All these people are starving to death, you know. They expect you to solve the situation, take away the suffering. You cannot. Because all of that is a research project that aspects of spirit are carrying out, and they want to carry it out. They may scream on the surface, but deep down, they are fascinated by it. You cannot interfere with that. You can't change the effects of an idea. To do so would be to lose your realization of yourself, thinking that the effects of a cause can be changed. It cannot. You have to allow things to happen here as they happen. Grant your brother, your aspect of spirits here, to continue their research. They have every right to do so. You cannot interfere with it. Their will is just, they are functioning with ideas and effects just as you are. And there's no way you can change that causation and effects. You cannot separate the two. Some people call it karma, etc., but it's really much simpler than that. Certain adjustments can be made in time and space, but that does not really doesn't change the idea at all. The effects will still continue to come. The difficulties and negations. For instance, someone can say, "Well, I really don't not interested in this smallpox or this sickness I have. I'm really not interested, so I'm willing to give it up." And then they can be healed. But what they'll do is then they go to some other negation, some other form of negation. They say, I'm more interested in this form of negation. And so they will suffer in that form of negation. So it doesn't cure anyone. That's not curative at all. In some cases, there are those who want to give up some type of negation research and go into some other type of research that might be a little less intense, less involved, and that may help them gradually turn away from negation altogether. That's possible. So there is certain types of grace that can function in the world, in this world, in that way. But ultimately, the only thing that can really be done is to exchange ideas. Otherwise, you're just treading water. So it's ridiculous to ask that the teacher, the great teachers, the great gurus, the saviors, say, to fix the problems here of the world, fix your problems. Only minor adjustments can be made, but the problems will remain in one form or the other. All you're doing is shuffling the deck. If you change one problem for another, one research into one type of negation, into research into another type of negation. Sometimes it's better just to suffer with what you have and gain clarity about the entire picture in that way, instead of trying to desperately get rid of whatever trouble you have. Kind of just accept it and say, okay, why am I choosing to research into negation in the first place? Not just this suffering I have, but all suffering. Not just mine, but everyone's. Why are we all doing this? Because each aspect of spirit that is here chose the idea of they want to become prime creator. They thought this is a very interesting idea. And they want to see how it plays out. So they're here playing it out. And of course they don't like it. But they're still fascinated by it. They think, wow, if I can just put up with this suffering and misery, maybe I can become prime creator. Maybe I'll be the one that actually finds this power of negation. Maybe my death will be it, you know. And there are religions that have a sacrificial victim And they claim that the sacrifice of that person, that is it, that they now have the power of negation over God. And therefore now they feel safe and powerful. And they feel that now they've on even terms with God. Because they can say, God, if you try to attack us, we have this power of negation. We've discovered it. And we're going to negate you. So let's have a truce. Let's have peace based on mutual deterrence. That's ultimately what these teachings give you in the world, is mutual deterrence, which is just ridiculous. You don't need any deterrence because God is not trying to attack anyone or anything. There is a sort of like a some sort of quasi satisfaction with believing that you've made some kind of truce of mutual deterrence with God. But it's an uneasy type of feeling, really. There might be some bursts of euphoria and hope. False hope, though. That's not salvation. Salvation is realizing you don't need any deterrence. You don't need any sacrificial victims. You don't need any power of negation. Your hands can be empty. You go to God with empty hands. No weapons. No psychic powers. Nothing. And you have a good laugh together. And that's it. You don't go to God with all sorts of secret weapons and saying, God, look what I have. You can see this playing out in the nations of the world, can't you? Mutual deterrence. They say, look, I've got the bomb. You've got the bomb. We better not attack each other. So let's call it peace. It's always the way in this world, isn't it? All sorts of weapon systems that try to balance out. Everyone's trying to protect each other from attack. Trying to protect themselves from attack. It's playing out still. Can you believe it? Of course you have to believe it, because it's true. Look at, we're trying to prevent, you know, other countries from getting weapons of mass destruction. They're trying to get weapons of mass destruction so they can deter our aggression against them, but they fear, you know, on and on and on it goes. All of that based on choosing the idea of trying to be prime creator, therefore needing to research into negation, believing that God is angry at us for trying to destroy God, the prime creator, and is out to try and destroy us first, and we need to defend ourselves against that. So we're playing out these scenarios of attack and counterattack and protection, defensiveness, and we're trying to develop defense systems. That's what the world really is. It is what it is. Don't try and paint a rosy picture. Don't put a beautiful gilded frame around it. Let's look straight at the facts. Look at all the weapon systems. Now the atmosphere and space around the planet is full of satellites, various types of weapon systems in space, developing very sophisticated weapon systems on the ground that use all sorts of very advanced technology. And there's a constant arms race. That's what's happening. That's what's always been happening on this planet. Just because we can go to the mall and buy some fashionable clothes doesn't change that one bit. We live in fear here. Doesn't matter how we try to block it out, it's still there. We're still afraid of God. We're still believing we need some sort of defense. That's why we're here in the world. If you really believe you didn't need any defense whatsoever, you would very easily ascend to the death-free realms. You'd repent very easily. You go to God and with nothing. And you just have a good laugh. That's it. That's simple. And then you know that you're free to choose any idea you want to choose. And this dream, this hypothetical scenario of researching into negation had no effect on reality whatsoever, had no effect on you, had no effect on the prime creator. had no effect on the functioning of reality, the will of reality, the authority of reality. Zero effect on reality. Never will have any effect on it. It's all a waste of time. And those who do that are fortunate, but all other aspects of spirit will also do this at some point. They'll get bored of these stupid games they're playing. They'll get tired of the fear, tired of the suffering. They'll find themselves in a situation where they're able to finally really contemplate all of this and begin to see through the absurdity of it all. Eventually, when you don't want to research into negation, you find yourself having the opportunity to really research into truth. And all around you, everybody is still frantically, you know, doing their deterrence things, playing the combat games, and playing these subtle, tricky ego power play games and all of that stuff. Social climbing. You know, you don't get engaged in any of that. You're just researching into truth. Truth is that God is not angry. We don't need any deterrence. We don't need any defense. We just need to exchange ideas. That's it. The more you hear this, the clearer it becomes. You realize it is possible to think in this way. It is possible to see things this way, to have this perspective on the world. And I'm sure that you have had something like this. Maybe you wouldn't express it exactly like this. But you have glimpses, no doubt. You've seen, I see my freedom. It's there. It's just this world is such a crazy place. It's hard to remain clear about it. Very difficult. But that's what teachers do. I'm just a mid-level teacher. Capable of a little bit of help here, able to put it into words, to clarify it for you, to reinforce what you've seen. But really, the work is done in this way. Those who work on it just in this sort of mid-level, mundane way of clarifying, continuously working hard at it every day, that's the ones who get it done. It's the tortoise that wins the race. The hare is jumping. The hare is jumping all over the place. But, you know, after they jump around, they go to sleep for quite some time. The hare wakes up and there's the tortoise down the road already finished. So it's the one that just keeps plodding along. Those are the ones who finally exchange ideas. Because they become very familiar with the whole situation. So keep working at it. Keep listening. Don't worry if other people aren't listening, because if they're not, they may be engaged in trying to work on some defensiveness, which is a waste of time, as you know. No need for that. Just work on clarifying the actual truth of the situation and the options that you have. Exchange ideas and ultimately relocate to the death-free realms. Maybe even as soon as 2012, for some of us. Okay, very great, that's it.
Thank you.